Hi, I'm Louis Viera from Tampa City Council, and you're watching Tampa Bay Community Network.
I'm Bill Hodges, and this is Spotlight on Government. And today, we're going to concentrate on Tampa City Government with Councilman Louis Viera.
Thank you, Bill. How are you?
Glad to have you on the show.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
When did you get elected into office? Let's let people know a little bit of your background.
Yes, sir, Bill. I got elected in December of 2016, about 8.5 months ago or so. It was an election to fill the remainder of Councilwoman Lisa Monteleone's term. She had left the city council to run for state legislature, thereby opening up her seat, and we had a runoff on December 6th of 2016.
Now, I understand you're a reasonably accomplished attorney. With a good practice?
I think so. You know, I'm a civil litigator. I'm an attorney at now the law firm of Cole Scott and Cassan, a larger firm where I concentrate in civil litigation. And I'm of counsel because obviously when you're in city council and in city government, you have a lot of other things to focus on.
Well, why would you take on a political job? Because nobody likes politicians, you know that.
Well, it's true. I mean, it's certainly an endeavor that's difficult, but you know, when I looked at entering into the campaign, I thought it was something that I could do, and most important, really, something that I thought I could really make a difference in. And I think that some of the things that we're doing now, I think kind of, I'm glad to say, justify the efforts we put in.
You know, no matter what politician I've ever talked with or known, be honest with them, They always go in with the idea that I can make a difference.
Yes, precisely. Yes.
And that would be your challenge, to stay with that.
Yes, sir. Yep. You've got to continue to have that heart that made you get into this effort in the first place, because running for office is a sacrifice. Public service, whether you're Republican or a Democrat or God forbid, an independent, it's always going to be a sacrifice on your time, on your wallet, certainly on your family. And it's something that if you're going to do, you have to make sure that you make a difference.
And you look out. And this is the thing, folks. Any of you thinking about running for politics? And you say, well, you know, he wasn't in his office at 10 o'clock. Mm-hmm. But were you with him the night before when he was at a gathering he had to be till 11 or 12?
Yeah, and I certainly keep myself busy in that regard. Trust me, I'm a very busy council member.
And is there any time that you can call your own?
Yeah, you have to make it. I mean, it's you know, on Saturdays I'll usually have one or two community events that I go to and whatnot. But the key is to liking what you do. God help you if you run for office and you get in there and you find out you don't like it. That would be a big mistake, because it's a lot of work. Let's put it that way.
And it's also a commitment from family, and you have a family. I know at least one young son.
Yes, sir. I have a son, my son Lewis, who's 10 years old, and he's a great kid. And you know, Lewis is a marvelous son, and he comes with me to a lot of different community events and whatnot. And I always think it's a good experience for him. It's a good experience on learning his community, on learning ways in which to serve your community, and just learning more about our city and the way government works.
I absolutely love it when they get the young people involved.
Yes. Oh, yeah, sure.
And really, we need to do more of that, folks. We need to get young people involved in these campaigns. You know, they can fold things, they can do flyers. And I don't care whether you're Republican or Democrat or independent. Getting these kids involved early will cause them to have some desire to want to serve and be a part of our country later on.
And I would say, Bill, my life certainly reflects that. I was involved the day I turned 18. I registered to vote. For me, it was a patriotic thing to do, and to go register to vote. I haven't missed an election since then. And in college, I volunteered on campaigns, and I was, you know, politically involved for a long time, and also involved in a lot of different civic efforts and organizations and trying to improve our community, because politics to me is one means to the end of improving our community, but not everything rests with government and politics. There's church, there's private charities, etc. And I certainly try to invest myself in all those endeavors.
And that's important. Volunteerism is the hub.
Yes, yes.
Really, and maybe that's a little bit of something we need to talk about someday. It's just volunteerism.
Yes.
Because I know you're busy working on certain things. Now, you're in District 7.
Yes, sir.
Now, not all of our people will know roughly mm-hmm. where the boundaries are for 7. So would you like to share that with us?
Yes, sir, Bill. Thank you. District 7 is commonly referred to as North Tampa. That includes Forest Hills area, Copeland Park area, University Square area, as well as the New Tampa area. It's a very diverse district. And, you know, it's a district that isn't unified by one need in particular. What one area needs can be very distinct from what another area needs. But I think that one thing that unifies all that district, which is North Tampa, is really a need for more attention and respect from the city of Tampa. And that's one of the things that we're trying to work on.
Well, I think that's extremely important. What would you consider the most important immediate needs for Tampa?
Well, for the overall city of Tampa, I would probably say that transportation is our biggest issue. You know, and everybody says that. But I always tell people that transportation is important for all of us. But I always tell people that when you look at transportation, you don't look at transportation, number one, starting for Louis Viera, the lawyer who's looking to cutting down his commute from Hunter's Green to downtown from maybe 50 minutes to 42 minutes. The real challenge in transportation is that 32-year-old CNA who's a single mom raising two kids, earning $11 an hour, being at a job she's been at for 10 years, who's looking at investing less time in commuting and more time with her family, more time earning money. That's where transportation matters most.
The reason, Lewis, when you started out with that as the number one, mm-hmm. I just picked up my cousin Norm Fisher, who lives near Berkeley in California.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the very first question that Norm asked me was, what's transportation like, public transportation?
Yeah. Yeah.
He can leave his home where he lives and be in downtown San Francisco mm-hmm. on BART in about 20, 25
yeah.
minutes.
Yeah.
At a reasonable cost.
Yeah, yeah.
And we are out in Sun City Center.
Yeah.
And he was talking about going over to maybe to St. Pete to see mm-hmm. one of the museums.
Yeah.
And there's no easy way to do that.
Oh, there's not.
Not with public transportation.
There's not, and it's something that acutely affects many of the areas within my district, Forest Hills, New Tampa. We're going to be starting to work on soon on trying to get a couple of investments in this area in particular, something that I'm very excited about that I'm hoping to work with the Florida Department of Transportation on, Bill, is having some sort of a transit connector between the University of South Florida and downtown Tampa. We're seeing an economic link between these two communities now by having the University of South Florida Medical School in downtown Tampa. I think that having some sort of a transit connector between these two communities would not only benefit people in terms of enhancing this area, but would also really bring jobs to the area and bring a level of convenience to the transportation challenge that would benefit a lot of people in this area.
I don't go downtown.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I really don't. I'm mm-hmm. not going to put up with that crap. Seriously. The traffic's horrible.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday, which was a Sunday,
yep.
I went downtown. I had to go to the airport and mm-hmm. pick my cousin up.
Mm-hmm.
We got in the car, driving, beautiful, sunny, bright day,
yeah.
Sunday afternoon, well, just around noon.
Mm-hmm.
And we start back, and the traffic on Interstate 275 mm-hmm. was absolutely parking lot.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's no ball games, there's yeah. not, but, and it's a Sunday.
Yeah, yeah.
Why would anybody purposely go down there unless they had to?
Yeah, and you know, whenever I take a look at the transportation challenges that we have, there's people who focus on more roads, there's people who focus on bus, there's people who focus on mass transit. I think that they're all really necessary. A lot of studies show that if you were to implement 100%, you know, world-class mass transit system here in the city of Tampa and our community, that would just take care of a minority of the drivers at the very least and get them off the road. And that's something that I favor. I strongly favor a mass transit system. But we need more.
In the beginning, that might be the case because mm-hmm. the people aren't used to using it.
Precisely.
But I go to Atlanta mm-hmm. and I go to other cities, Salt Lake City.
Yep.
I go out to San Francisco where the people have had some time to use these and get used to the transit systems and how they work. Mm-hmm. And they're crowded.
Oh yeah, sure. And I'm confident that if we get that in the city of Tampa or in our community in the Tampa Bay area, that we can do that. That also requires regional cooperation with our neighbors. That's something that's very important. We've got to build on the success that we've seen with Pinellas County and St. Petersburg. That's something that I'm committed to doing.
And Hillsborough County.
Oh yeah, sure.
Great with St. Petersburg and Clearwater and all that, but people don't fly into Brandon.
Yes.
Yeah. They don't fly into Sun City Center. Mm-hmm. They go to Tampa.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And we've got to quit thinking of us as a us and them.
Yes. No, I agree.
And it needs to be a lot of effort on the part of county commissioners, mm-hmm. the council, to become Tampa area rather than this one little microcosm called Tampa, mm-hmm. and then this huge county sitting out there saying, but that's not us.
And you're right. I think we've, in the last few years, improved our relationship with Hillsborough County. That's something that I'm trying to do in my own job, for example. I was telling you while we were talking about some of the town halls we've been doing. I had a town hall last week with County Commissioner Pat Kemp. I used to do them by myself. Now I'm bringing somebody with the county so that we can build that relationship with the county. I'm having two
it's
more
a wonderful
set up.
Idea.
Oh, yeah. And I'm having two more set up, one with Victor Chris, another one with Ken Hagen, because I want to build relationships with the county. The city can do very little on its own when it comes to a big issue like transportation. We need to build coalitions between the county and the city, coalitions between Republicans and Democrats. We live in a very divided time. And I think that if we want to see progress on the issue of transportation, that we've got to build bridges. And that's certainly something that I'm committed to doing.
You mentioned three of my favorite people. Mm-hmm. They're all very good commissioners. Sure. They don't all agree.
Oh, no.
But they're all, I think, people who haven't forgotten they came here to do something for the people.
Certainly,
like
sure.
We talked about it at the very beginning. Mm-hmm. One of the other areas that you're involved in is veterans.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Can we talk a little bit about, because that's, again, near dear to my heart.
Yes, sir. I know you're an Air Force veteran, you said. Yes. A couple of things doing. One of the things that when I got into city council that I wanted to do in the North Tampa area was to build a sense of community and identity. Identity. We can talk some later about some of the councils that we've helped create in the North Tampa area. But one of the associations that I'm very proud of is something called the North Tampa Veterans Association. It was something that I wanted to start because we have so many veterans in this area. You take a look at Forest Hills. You take a look at the New Tampa area. A lot of veterans go there to retire. University of South Florida, recently rated by Military Times as the second best school for returning veterans.
Really?
Yeah. So we have a lot out here in North Tampa. We have the VA just outside of the district. So
and
we
by
have
the way,
a lot.
That VA is second to none.
Yeah.
I don't know where any others are, mm-hmm. but that VA, James Haley, is mm-hmm. outstanding.
And that's good to hear, and I mean that. So we have a lot of different things here with veterans, and I thought that we could have an area or an organization identified as the area of North Tampa for veterans. And like I was telling you before, Bill, I'm surprised, pleasantly surprised, at how well this organization has done. We get between 20 to 30, 35 individuals coming to our meetings who are involved. We have a group of men and women, about six or seven, who are now running it. You know, my job was to organize the people and identify the right people to run it, and now it's really off and running. It's been out for a couple of months, but they're already doing things in the community and building towards things. So again, it's new, but we see a lot of heart.
Oh, I think
that
it'll expand drastically. I don't know whether you've ever gone by the Bob Evans. They have things for veterans there.
Oh,
Bob
sure.
Evans.
Yeah, sure.
Ours down Sun City is just absolutely overflowing.
Yeah.
There's not enough chairs to put people in.
Yeah, and it's again just our way of saying thank you for people's service, you know. And
where do they meet?
That's a good question. We started meeting at the New Tampa Library over off Cross Creek,
okay.
And they've also met at the VA. Last week they met over at the University of South Florida, the ROTC Center there. So they're kind of shifting in terms of where they meet, because it is not, it's an organization for all of North Tampa. So they're seeking to meet in different areas of North Tampa. So there's no one place.
Kind of dangerous though in formation of a new group to move them around, because people don't get used to going to to the same place. Maybe it's good, I don't know.
And that is a very good point in the sense that people can become confused, but given the fact that it's new and we're trying to recruit from different areas, like when we began, many of our members were from New Tampa, and now we're looking at recruiting much more in the Forest Hills area, in the USF area, et cetera, because there's so many veterans out there.
But you also get into what we talked about the first time, mm-hmm. transportation.
Oh, sure.
I went to this meeting in my neighborhood, but I can't get to this one over here.
No,
so those are another subgroup, mm-hmm. as you mentioned, the mother who needed help.
Mm-hmm.
But there's another subgroup, our elderly, or people who are served and need that help.
Without a doubt. And, you know, if you're somebody coming from a section in Forest Hills, for example, to the New Tampa Library, that could take you 30 minutes in bad traffic. So that certainly, which is why we're trying to shift up.
If you have a car to drive.
Exactly. If you have a car to drive, and that's a very good point. So those issues intertwine. You know, and something else that I'm very excited about, too, that was recently in the paper, Bill, is the Warrior Games, which we talked about.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, which is a great thing that we're really trying to get, to use recent military lingo, a coalition of the willing of different people and business organizations and government leaders to try to lobby to get this effort here in Tampa.
Well, this is a sports area anyway.
I think it is.
People would turn out to see.
Yes, it is. And the Warrior Games, for your viewers who may not know what it is an effort that allows injured, disabled, or wounded veterans to compete in competitive sports, much like the Olympics. This past year in the city of Chicago, about 50,000 people came to see the Warrior Games.
50,000?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And about 265 individuals, veterans, participated, including a gentleman, Mike Nicholson, who is a United States Marines, lost, I believe it is, both his legs and one of his arms. I believe it is in Afghanistan due to a bomb. And he won 6 gold medals. God bless him.
Wow.
And he's from the city of Tampa, and he makes us very, very proud. It goes without saying. And I read about that effort in an article by Howard Altman in the Tampa Bay Times and how this man, Mr. Nicholson, is by himself trying to get the Warrior Games here. So I did a motion before city council to have city council write the Department of Defense to try to get the Warrior Games here. So that's something that we're working behind.
And how about the Visitors Convention Bureau? They should be working on this too.
Oh yes, we reached out as well to Visit Tampa Bay. I met with their head individual. I've reached out also to the County Commission. I've reached out to the Greater Tampa Chamber of Commerce and to different elected officials, and all with, you know, very positive results. Like I mentioned before, it's a very divided time in our country, but I think that one of the things that brings us together, Bill, is the service of our veterans, especially these days, how poignant it is and how relevant it is that we've had 15 straight years of deployments since 9/11. And we have too many of our veterans coming back injured. And these games are a way to allow these veterans to display the spirit that got them involved in the military in the first place, that spirit, that commitment to community. And that's why I want them here. And especially because the city of Tampa is such a pro-veteran city. We have so much to offer. We have such a great military history here in the city of Tampa. We're a very patriotic city, and I think that we can get them here, hopefully.
Yeah, I'm a lifetime member of the DAV, the Disabled American Veterans.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And in honesty, that's a great group.
Sure.
And there's a lot of great groups. How can my listeners actually help make this happen?
That's a great question. They can, number one, contact my office to get further inquiry on this. And they can also contact, I would probably say, their member of Congress to make sure that he or she writes the Department of Defense, because this is a federal issue. This is the Department of Defense. I'm merely the city councilman from District 7.
Who runs the games?
It's the Department of Defense.
Oh, DOD runs the games?
I believe
games.
It's the Department of Defense. Yep,
okay.
Yep. So, and I know that there's various institutions and entities that are lobbying for this to happen within the city of Tampa. So that's, I would say, the best thing that your viewers can do is to contact their member of Congress so that he or she can, you know, lobby the Department of Defense and see if we can get the Warrior Games here. It would be a great thing for the city of Tampa. And we don't just have the heart to do it in terms of patriotism and values. We have the muscle to do it. Let's not forget, we hosted the Republican National Convention in 2012.
True.
We had Clint Eastwood here that year. You know, we're a city that can host a lot. We can take a lot as a city, and I think we can do this.
Well, we've got a lot of senior officers retired here, too, that have clout with the Pentagon.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir. And we have approximately 200,000 veterans in the greater Tampa Bay area. That includes not just Tampa, but the greater Tampa Bay area. That's a lot of veterans. I believe that's among the highest for a region in the United States of America. We ought to be proud of that. I mean, again, that's a value that brings us together. People ask me why I've worked a lot on veterans issues since I've been elected. Number one, I was committed to that before I was elected, because that's something that brings us together. And one of the things, Bill, that I've tried to govern with, an idea, is building bridges, is the idea that it's a public official's job to bring people together, not to divide them.
Boy, you know, I agree with that.
I have a saying, which is that 80% of the American people can agree on 80% of the issues. Maybe that's naive, but I don't think that it is.
No, I don't think it's wrong at all.
Yeah. We've got a lot of folks out there on all sorts of political sides who love to divide the American people. I'm not going to be that kind of politician.
We've got a ton of one-issue voters.
Oh, yeah.
I'm an R because I have this issue, or I'm a D because I have this issue. I don't care what else the party thinks.
Yeah, sure.
They support me on this one issue.
Yeah.
And if you can get past that issue, you can find out there's a lot of people who have a lot of things in common.
Oh, you're darn right. Yeah, you do. So,
you know, we've got just a few more minutes and I don't want to miss anything that you think is important that we ought to be talking about. You want to talk about the budget a little bit?
Yes, sir. I think that's really...
I know there's a tax increase on the table, which I'm not... Of course, I'm not going to pay it because I live in Sun City. But I'm really not against it in principle, because I see so many things now where politicians say, I cut your taxes, and then turn it right around, put user fees on everything, toll roads, beaches, which makes no sense because... But not everybody pays them, but somebody will pay all of them along the way. And so let's talk a little bit about the budget.
And that's a very important issue, Bill. I always start off issues with the budget by saying 2 + 2 = 4. In other words, if you want the 4, you got to get the 2 + 2 to pay for it. One of the issues that's arisen is that very soon the city of Tampa is going to have to pay a $20 million debt. It's coming. What's that saying? The chickens are coming home to roost on the creation of the downtown police station. Another $6 million debt for an investment in Ybor, plus with an expected passage of a $25,000 addition to the homestead exemption, we're going to lose another $6 million. I think it's clear that there's going to have to be some sort of tax increase or revenue enhancement. The issue is going to be how much and for how long. You know, there have been a lot of different discussions, Bill, in terms of maybe tailoring it to the life of the debt. Whether or not that can be done, we'll have to explore that. But that's essentially what's going to happen. Now, within the budget of the city of Tampa, there are a lot of good things that I'm very proud of for my district. The new Tampa Rec Center is going to get an additional $2 million out of that budget. We're going to get a new fire station, about a $10 million investment, and something, Bill, that's very, very close to my heart that I'm so proud of. Again, one of the things that you look at and you go, that's why I ran for office, is we have development for design in the budget for an autism sensory-friendly park within our district. That is a park that will accommodate children with different neurological deficits and autism, and it's going to be the first of its kind in our area, and it's going to be within District 7 because of this budget. So that's something that we're very proud of. But when it comes to the tax issue, something that I'm doing right now is to have numerous town halls. We've already had 4 town halls, and I'm going to have more to discuss this budget, because I want to see what my constituents think about this issue.
What do they think?
That's a good question.
How are you being greeted? I see a lot of the things on television. Mm-hmm. Of course, they're going to show me the things that are riotous. Yeah.
Sure.
But how are you being greeted as you go out and do these town halls?
Oh, very well. I would say very well. And it's no different, I'll be honest, than when I knocked on over 1,000 doors and ran for office. I think that most people appreciate what I would suggest is sincerity. When you just go, look, I'm here to listen to you and to talk about the issues. I don't have an agenda. I'm not looking for attention. I'm your public servant and I want to listen. So I think that 99% of people have reacted well in that regard, including people who tell me, listen, Lewis, I didn't vote for you in the election, but I really appreciate your taking the time to listen to me. That's what being a public servant is about listening.
Well, speaking of that, I promised you that give you 1 to 2 minutes to actually talk to the people who elected you and thank them.
Yes,
and
sir.
Assure those that didn't vote for you that you're still going to represent them, too.
Oh, yeah.
So would you like to take that time?
Sure, yeah. Hey. I just wanted, again, thank everybody from District 7 for voting for me. And as Bill indicated, it's something that is truly an honor. It's truly an honor to represent you in District 7 for City Council. I'm certainly working hard towards many of the things that I think bring us together. I think that you can agree that a lot of the things that we've talked about here today, things like transportation, things like making Tampa, further putting Tampa on the map for things like veterans, for things like autism awareness, these aren't things that are Republican or Democrat. These are things that just make sense. These are things that when you talk at the kitchen table with your family, you talk about in terms of your everyday issues. I promise that with me as your city councilman, you have somebody who's going to bring us together. I'm proud to work with Republicans and Democrats, with people from the city, with people from the county, with the business community, from the labor community, to try to get a resolution of the issues that affect us. And the biggest issue that affects us isn't a Republican issue or a Democrat issue. It's an issue of respect. It's an issue of attention for North Tampa, which has so much to offer the city of Tampa. And I promise you that I will continue to work to earn that respect that North Tampa deserves. Again, thank you so much for your trust in me, as it's something that I work hard for because I never take it for granted. Thank you.
Well, Lewis, that's great. Mm-hmm. It really is, because I think those are the things that are very, very important.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I would love to have you come back and be with us again.
I'd love to be here.
Of course, we have to keep our lights on, so keep that in mind when that big budget comes rolling.
I was lobbied. Yep, I was lobbied.
But I would really love to have you on the show.
Thank you, Bill.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Bill Hodges, and this is Spotlight on Government. We want you to remember, you're unique, you're special, and you're great. Tell us so often because you are. And Lewis, you probably got a list of things that we didn't cover, but we're going to be sure we cover those on the next time around.
I look forward to it.